Thank you for joining us today, and we'll be starting shortly. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to Aspire 2020, a celebration of the journey of our change leaders. My name is Parul, and I'll be your host for the evening. We're streaming this event live on Facebook, and you can find the link for the same on your chat box. Throughout the course of the event, if you have any comments, suggestions, or questions, we request you to use the Q&A or the chat box for the same. We're also recording this on Zoom, and we'll be posting it on Facebook. So please do not forget to like our Facebook page. In the last couple of months, when COVID entered our lives and we were in a fix to deal with the situation, civil society organizations continued to fight the good battle on ground. From ensuring access to food for the underserved to ensuring continuity in education for the children, these social entrepreneurs have been the front runners in solving the challenges this crisis presented us with. Edumentum is fortunate to be working with some of these change leaders in the ecosystem. And through Aspire 2020, we bring you their stories and experiences. While these young change leaders work relentlessly towards solving the challenges in their spheres, we have ecosystem champions who have witnessed and have been active participants in bringing a change in the education system of India. I would like to begin the conference by inviting one such champion whose commitment to transforming education has brought about change in the lives of countless children. I'm talking about none other than Mr. S.D. Shibulal. Since 1990s, Mr. Shibulal and Ms. Kumari Shibulal started their philanthropic endeavors, and post that their commitment to education has transpired innovation in the ecosystem like never before. Mr. S.D. Shibulal is the co-founder of Infosys and the trustee of the Shibulal Family Philanthropic Initiative. With his keen interest in improving education, he has supported several organizations across the country. He recognizes the need for change makers and believes in equipping them with technology and resources to further their cause for education. So without any further ado, I would like to invite Mr. Shibulal to open today's session by sharing his views on opportunities in the times of crisis, the way forward for civil society organizations. Over to you, sir.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening, sir.
It's a great pleasure for me to be here. Thank you for inviting me to give this keynote address. So our journey with education started in 1999 when we were setting up the Shibulal Family Philanthropic Initiative, myself and Kumari. We were making a choice on which area to spend time on. And it was very evident to us very quickly that education is the field which we should choose. There are many reasons for it. Number one is the fact that whatever we did in our life, whatever Kumari and me did in our life, whatever we achieved, All that was from the benefit of the education which we got as young people. So our life happened because of the education which we received. There are many other reasons. Education, in my mind, is a great equalizer. In fact, it is probably the greatest equalizer. It is a potent enabler. It enables people to achieve high aspirations. It's a passport to upward mobility in the society. And it is fundamental to creating an equitable society. It creates opportunities for the young people. It builds human capital. So it is all the more important to a country like India. And what we have seen over the last 20 years is that education is the cornerstone for development to break the cycle of poverty. So we decided to focus on education in 1999. We did a number of things over the years. We started out with a higher education program in 99, which have now grown into a larger endeavor. So we started working in the K-12 space. I've always said this, that our country is a country of contradictions. In any sector which we look. So on one hand, we produce 1 million engineers every year. But we have millions of children who are not in school. If you look at healthcare, for example, 70% of our doctors are in urban areas and 70% of the population is in the rural areas. I can go on and on these contradictions. Our gross enrollment ratio is now close to 85% in K-12 education. But by the time you go to higher education, it is 26%. Our aim for higher education actually was 30% by 2030. And now I think we have moved it in the new education policy, we have moved it to 35% by 2035. We will still be behind countries like China, which is at 43%, and US, which is at 86%. Of course, we have come in a very long way over the years. Our literacy rate today is 76% compared with 17% in 1950. So we have made significant improvements. We have come a long way in increasing the literacy levels over the years. Our education network is a very complex thing. We have 1.5 million schools, close to 200 million enrolled students, 4.5 million school leaders, 850 universities, and 40,000 higher education institutions in the country. So when RT was introduced in 2010, the purpose was to improve access to education. And I think after 2010, our gross enrollment ratios have gone up and we have improved access to education. But the quality of education, especially in the government schools and in the semi-private schools, deserve a lot. There are many challenges in this space. The size is a big challenge, 1.5 million schools. The teacher-student ratios are pretty bad when it comes to government schools. So if you look at a study done by Acer in 2019, in 26 rural districts, only 16% of class 1 students can read. And even class 5 students cannot read a class 2 textbook. The new education policy aims at improving the situation. It is aiming for 100% enrollment. It is aiming for increasing gross enrollment ratio in higher education. But more importantly, I think there is a focus on quality, which has come in. I think it's commonly accepted that while RTE has improved access to education, the quality of education deserves a lot. Of course, things have become much more complex. Given the COVID-19 pandemic, it has disrupted everyone's life, more importantly, the children's life. Government across the world have shut down the operations. Schools are yet to open. In India also, millions of children are out of school. So, if you look at all these challenges, in many ways, we are, the most important need for us is to have change in the K-12 education. Right? There is enormous amount of improvements required, enormous amount of new thinking required, and major changes required in K-12 to increase the quality, at the same time, making sure that the access continue to go up. All our experience, all my experience and all the experience of each and everyone on this team have taught us that change requires strong leadership. Leadership which is capable of making observations, identifying areas of change, implementing solutions, measuring impact, and creating a continuous cycle of improvement. As I said, this is a very complex, large system. It is very hard for it to make quantum jumps in improvements, which means we need to build a cycle of continuous improvements. And that is possible only if we have strong leadership available in the education field. Hence the journey of Shiksha Logam. Shiksha Logam was started with a single objective: systemic improvement through leadership development. That was the single objective behind starting of Shiksha Logam. See, when I think about leadership, there are multiple aspects which comes to my mind. Number one is the role of the leaders. What is the role of a leader? In my mind, the leader's primary job is to raise the aspirations. Leader's job is to inspire. Leaders need to remain calm, confident, and focused, even in tough times, like what it is today. Of course, leaders need to identify change and create solutions, not create, co-create solutions along with the various stakeholders. They should be able to prioritize. They should be able to do ABC analysis, look at the high impact items, and put resources behind those changes. The way of a leader should not be autocratic. Autocratic solutions have a way of falling behind, falling by the wayside, even when they are the best solutions. Co-creation of solutions bring participation, buy-in, and a higher level of commitment by the stakeholders involved. So the first point, the role of the leaders is to create, is to inspire and to raise aspirations. The next important thing is the actions by the new leaders. How does the leader act? First and foremost, the leader should walk the talk. The leader is the role model which people will look up to. The leader is the person whom others will imitate. Leaders need to be at the forefront of driving change. In many ways, the leader has to be the change. He is the first person to change so that others will believe in him and follow him. but should not be in the forefront of taking credit. Leader's job is to lead from the front, but not to be the one who is taking credit from the front. Leaders have to give visibility to others who are in the system, give credit to others, recognize and give credit to others. In many ways, a true leader will allow others to take the limelight while supporting the team to achieve higher goals. Rarely, while leaders should get into details, leaders should not micromanage. The impact, measuring the impact, making sure that the effort is producing the required results or the expected results, in many ways, is the role of the leader. Leaders need to remain objective, unemotional in many ways, focus on data, and transaction-oriented. Right? They need to have the ability to close a transaction and move on. In my mind, every leader, no one is perfect. That means we need to continue to learn. Leader is no exception. They should have the ability to learn and self-correct. And most importantly, humble enough to accept mistakes. They should build a culture of collaboration and co-creation, because our problems are very complex and very large. To create solutions which are contextual, you need collaboration and co-creation. The third point which comes to my mind about the leader is the leader's beliefs. I believe a leader should be fair. More importantly, equally seen as fair. It is not only being fair, it is being seen as fair, honest, transparent, non-hierarchical in his approach. As I said, have an open mind to learn, willing to accept his own mistakes, and willing to roll up the sleeves and be in the trenches at times. So, as I said, the leader in many ways is the change maker. So it is with this single objective of enabling change makers within the system, Shiksha Logam was formed. Our journey so far has been very interesting. Of course, Shiksha Logam consists of three different components, three different layers. At the core, there is a digital infrastructure. On top of that, you have a co-creation collaboration layer and an amplification layer. As I said, the journey so far has been very fulfilling. Today, I think Shiksha Logam operates in 19 states, 4 states in full, 3.5 leaders enrolled, about 500 to 600 transactions per second. In many ways, our objective of developing leaders or driving systemic change in the K-12 education through leadership development has made a good beginning. Like you have close to 4.5 million leaders in the system. So 3.2 lakhs is really not much, but I think we have made a good beginning. And when we look forward, the possibilities are infinite for collaboration and co-creation. With the emergence of the new normal after COVID, it is even more important to reinvent ourselves, and that requires leadership. And our focus has been to build these leaders. So lastly, before I conclude, I want to congratulate all the attendees of Cohort 2020 graduating today. I wish you all the best. I also welcome all of you into our fold. As change makers. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. We have a few questions for you now. I'll just read out the questions. So the first question is, if you can share some views on inclusive education and how can we enable it?
So I think, as I said right in the beginning, education is the greatest enabler, greatest equalizer which you can bring to the table for every young person in this country. And it has to happen without prejudice. It has to happen without differentiation. It cannot be based on any kind of criteria. It has to be based on, it has to be based on true merit. Right? Our experience with inclusive education is with our school, which is very interesting because probably we are the only school I know of where we have been able to bring together children from underserved communities and privileged communities. Now, this is pre-RTE. RTE happened in 2010. The school was started in 2000. The seeds of the school was done in 2004. And the school was started in 2007. So the integration happened before RTE. So when RTE came around, in many ways, it was easier for us. So our journey has been extremely fulfilling. So this year, last year, so we took children in 2004. When they were 3 years old and integrated them into a normal school in an inclusive manner. And the first two children, we were very, this was an experiment to start with. Today we have a large number of children, but at that time it was an experiment to start with. And right now we have the first two children graduated last year and one of them topped the school.
Wow.
So that shows that, this whole nurture versus nature argument, it shows that given the right opportunities, and even this year, we have next year we'll have a lot more children because we took snow. And both children, one went to St. Joseph's, one has gone to Christ.
That's amazing, sir.
Amazing, right? These are children whom we took in 2005 when they're 3 years old, who stayed with us through this program and studied in an inclusive environment. It has its challenges. I'm not saying it is not, but it can be done. And I think that is where, again, leadership matters.
Yes, definitely. Thank you so much, sir. Another question is, what are the opportunities for collaboration for organizations in the current situation?
So actually, this is the situation where we need to collaborate. Anyway, today, you cannot go and meet anybody, right? Actually, one thing I really find funny, even though people, I think, seem to collaborate much better on Zoom rather than in a meeting room. I don't know, this is the feeling I get. But this is the time for us to collaborate. See, we don't have the luxury of reinvention in this country. That we have to learn from each other. We have to, and Edmundum is a very good example of this whole philosophy, right? Edmundum is about learning from each other. It is not about us teaching all this. Edmundum is everything they need to know. They are actually learning from each other and continuing to collaborate, right? And it's a model in which while the invention happens in one part of one place, it is localized in the other place and contextualized by the Edmundi who is in the other location, right? So it's a good example of collaboration and co-creation. Just because we, and after this COVID, it is even more going to be challenging because today, even if you want to locally create, it is not easily possible, right? So there is an enormous amount of opportunity. And having a digital platform like Shikshalokam removes the barriers for collaboration because there are many barriers for collaboration. There is a physical barrier, there is a language barrier, there is a context barrier. Something like Shikshalokam, which is fully digital, which can be contextualized easily, and which is available throughout, removes the barriers for collaboration. And that is exactly what we are seeing now, right? We are seeing, so in Punjab, for example, I think some of our edmundis are created a collective, which is a great example of collaboration to achieve the same goals, right? See, I always believe that the intellectual property of an organization is in its capability to execute, not in the PPTs and the processes we create. A lot of people think, this is my PPT, this is my intellectual property, I will keep it with me. I tell them, boss, PPTs anybody can create, but to execute is very hard. So the intellectual property is in execution. So you can collaborate on the PPT. Anyway, you can't collaborate much on the execution because locally you are there. So people need to rethink how they see, how they view their core competencies and intellectual property.
Okay. Thank you so much. So due to limited time, I think we'll take one last question. And that is, how can young entrepreneurs stay motivated in these times and keep their teams motivated?
So I think, as I said, the leadership is about being calm at difficult times. I remember Mr. Murthy once telling me, Shibu, when one child is sick, the parent cannot panic because the other child will also panic. Yeah. It's a good example, right? Because I was having some very tough situation and Mr. Murthy was my mentor when I was at Infosys for all kinds of things. And I was having some tough situation and Mr. Murthy said, and I was trying to, look little hassled. And he said, Shibu, please remember, as a leader, if one child is sick, you cannot panic because the other child will also start panicking. So the leader's job is to make sure that you keep your head high. You be firm and focus on your focus on your objectives and make sure that you remain focused in tough times. Also, there is a saying which says, this shall also pass.
Yes, sir.
This shall also pass. Remember that. This shall also pass. So, as long as you can remain firm, you can remain focused, you can remain calm, you can remain objective, one should be able to go through these difficult times. And the as leaders, you have no luxury. You don't have the luxury of being disenchanted or hassled or disappointed, because it's your job to keep the motivation high. Your job to and we have seen n number of crises. Actually, I have a speech tomorrow. I was thinking about it. We have seen n number of crises, not at this scale, but we have seen other crises in the past: economic crisis, unemployment, wars, all kinds of things. We have come through many of them. In fact, we'll come through this. And when you come through this, I believe there will be a lot more new innovation which will happen, because every time when the humanity is faced with a huge crisis. Right. If you look at the results of Second World War, which is all negative, but you have the atomic power, you have enormous improvements in air travel, you name it. So similarly, when you come out of this, I think there will be enormous amount of opportunities and large amount of innovations which will happen.
Yes, sir. Definitely. I totally resonate with that. And so because there are a lot of questions which are flowing, I would just like to take one last question, and I promise this is the last question. So the question is, how can civil society organizations secure themselves financially in the trying times ahead?
So this is a time for everyone to tighten their belt a bit, whether you are in civil society, whether you are in business, you need to make sure that you are very frugal at this point in time, because every resource is stretched, right? So there are certain expenses which are not there today, because I see that all my organizations, the travel expenses become zero. The number of expenses have become suddenly. So, and at the same time, the people who are, you need to also remember saying that the people who are supporting you are also going through a tough time. Yeah. They're also going through a tough time. I believe that the people who truly believe in your cause will continue to support. Right? The alignment of objectives and cause becomes very important, because in tough times, what the person who supports will do is to try and align himself to the organizations where there is a clear alignment between his objectives and your objectives. So it is very important to make sure that you remain transparent, you remain aligned to the objective of the supporting organization. And you are very clear on your impact. You show impact is the one which will energize the support. And at the same time, remain very, very frugal, because the resources are really, really stretched all around. We ourselves had to divert resources from in one place to another, because food packet delivery and other things, which we did, which means that we diverted resources from one place to another, right? So the focus on preserving resources and being very, very frugal, focus on impact, making sure that you are aligned with the set of people who are supporting you. I think these are the three things which comes to my mind.
Definitely. Thank you so much, sir, for answering those questions. And thank you so much for taking our time out of your busy schedule and sharing these insights with our audience today. Over time, the ecosystem is realizing the various opportunities this crisis has highlighted, and your words have just reiterated the confidence amongst organizations to move forward with optimism and constantly innovate in their approach. And we are sure our viewers today have been energized after listening to you. So thanks a lot, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So moving ahead and taking from Shibu sir's speech, we already have institutional support through incubators available for the organizations to spearhead their ideas into reality. And one such institution is Edumentum. To talk more about it, I would like to invite my colleague, Ms. Poonam Shukla, who is the director of Edumentum. Over to you, Poonam.
Hi, thank you so much, Paral. Good evening, everyone, and it's a pleasure to have you all here. Hosting Aspire was a dream for this year, and it has come true, and we're very happy to share it with you. So before I start talking about the idea of Edumentum, I wanted to share a little story. And the story includes a flatbread with a lot of cheese, herbs, vegetables, or meat on it. Any guesses? Well, I think you've already thought about it. I am talking about pizza. So the story of pizza is as interesting as its taste. And it starts with the unification of Italy. So when Italy was unified, the king and queen of Italy decided to visit Naples. And one of the local chefs, Rafael Esposito, was given the task of creating an interesting dish for them because they were very bored of eating French food. So what this individual did was he created a dough pie, added some basil, mozzarella cheese, and tomato on it. And when it was served to the queen, she absolutely loved it. It went on to become very famous. It was called Margherita, which also happens to be the name of the queen. So what happened after that was, when the Neapolitans, they migrated to the US, they took the idea of pizza along with them. So one thing that I always find very interesting about this story is that all of these incidents happened almost 100 years ago. and even today we are eating pizza. So what are the key factors that are responsible for this? Now, when we closely analyze the idea of pizza, three things come to mind. The first one is that the idea of pizza is contextual. So wherever pizza has gone, it has taken up the local flavor. And from pepperoni to paneer makhani, we have all kinds of varieties of pizza available to us today. The second one is that the idea of pizza is adaptable. And we've seen over time, the idea of pizza has actually evolved. So from thick base to thin base, from cone to frozen, we have all kinds of variety again available to us. And the third part is that the idea of pizza is very easy to replicate. So no matter what country you go to in the world, you will definitely find a pizza joint. So why am I talking about these three key factors? If we try and connect it to the education ecosystem, and while we are working towards creating solutions for the massive educational inequity that we see around us, these three key factors give us a window of creating a good solution for that. And especially for a country as diverse as India, where the language, ethnicity, culture changes with every few kilometers, it also affects how a child learns in a context. And that's why a contextual solution is very important. With respect to adaptability, if we look at even the minor changes in the ecosystem, it affects the education of children. And we have seen that happen during COVID in the last couple of months, how it has affected the education of children across the country. And India is as diverse as it is large. And it's very important to keep the scale of the issue in mind while we are devising our solutions. So these were the three key beliefs which we had in mind back in 2017 when we were looking for ways to solve the educational crisis in the country, because we realized that it is not the job of a single organization or just a handful of organizations. And that's when we decided to solve the perennial issue of education in an entrepreneurial way. And so that's when the birth of Edumentum happened. Edumentum is a Shibulal family philanthropic initiative in partnership with Mantra for Change. It's a three-year incubation program, which is divided in three different phases. So in the first year of the program, in the first phase, we work closely with organizations. And these are the organizations which belong to the remotest part of the country. And they have their understanding of their geography and the context, the opportunities and challenges that it presents. So we work with them very closely to create a robust program and a robust organization. In the second year, what happens is, in the first year, the organizations work towards creating this robust program design. In the second year, they go ahead and prototype it with more operational units in the ecosystem. So for example, if they are working with two organizations in the first year, in the second year, they prototype it with five more organizations or schools on the ground. This gives them an opportunity to recalibrate the program and course correct. And by the time they reach the third year, their program is ready and it is robust and they're ready to scale. So this is what a journey of an Edumentee looks like in the program. And one of the spines of the program is the mentor support that we have. At Edumentum, we have been very fortunate to have some of the greatest minds in the ecosystem as our mentors. They have not only helped us as a program to grow, but also have been a great support to our partner organizations. And it is with their continuous support and belief in us, we have been able to support 32 organizations across 18 states in the country. We are now four cohorts strong. So I'll take a pause here and I will take you back to the three key points that I mentioned in the beginning, which was that an idea has to be, needs to be scalable. It needs to be adaptable and it needs to be contextual. And in the conversation with in his address, Shibu sir mentioned about all these components. And he has been a great guide to us as well. So over the past 3 years, all these three key components that we mentioned, our organizations have brought it alive with their work. And one of such opportunities has been the COVID crisis. So while it hit us out of nowhere, our partner organizations took some time and they went back to the ground, understood what was happening on the ground, got the pulse of it, and created solutions in response to what the stakeholders were going through. So from creating digital solutions to offline learning kits to partnering with state governments to build the capacity of teachers across states, they have done it all. And this has shown their agility and their capability to innovate constantly. And while our organizations are also working on the adaptability and contextual side of it, they are aware of the sheer scale of the problem. And that we have seen them demonstrate in the most creative way possible. So exactly a year ago, two of our edu mentees, Sanchi Sikhya and Samarthya, they joined hands with Mantra for Change and Siksha Lokam and formed a project management unit with the Punjab state government. And this started a legacy. And in the February of this year, two of our partner organizations, again, Karunodaya Foundation and iSaksham, joined their hands with five other organizations in the ecosystem, and they formed a collective in Bihar. And in as recent as June this year, we saw organizations from 10 different states coming together and forming a remote geographies collective, which is geared towards ensuring continuity of education of children in the remotest part of the country. And these are just a couple of examples of collaboration and collectives happening among our edu mentees. As Shibu sir also mentioned about the power of collaboration and collective thinking, which is required in the ecosystem, our edu mentees continue to drive it and demonstrate it over time. And I'm pretty sure with the sessions that we have put together for you, you will be able to hear about their stories from themselves. And I'm pretty sure it's bound to inspire you. We at Edumentum have been very fortunate to be working with these passionate and young change leaders. And if during the course of the interaction, you feel like connecting with any one of our individuals, and edumentees, we will be happy to provide that opportunity to you as well. So for that, we have created a short Google form, which will be circulated in your chat boxes. You can fill out the form and we will be happy to make the connections for you. So with that, I would like to stop my talk over here and hand it over to my colleague, Pal. Once again, thank you so much for joining us for the session, and it is an immense pleasure to have you here. I hope you have a great evening ahead. Over to you, Paral. Thank you.
Thank you, Poonam, for sharing the idea of Edumentum with all of us today. I think after listening to the pizza theory, whenever I will see pizza, I will only think about these three components that you've mentioned. So thank you for enlightening us on that in that respect. Working with Edumentum, I would agree that it is all about these three components, and our organizations continue to demonstrate these values on the ground. Going forward, we will see this coming alive in our sessions as well. As you have heard, that context is at the core of our program. We will start the conversation series today by understanding the role that it plays in shaping education. While we're aware of what education looks like in an urban setup, we should also focus our attention on the fact that more than 60% of India's children live in remote geographies of India with limited access to learning opportunities. This greatly reduces their chances of completing their education. In the wake of COVID, this situation has worsened, and in the future, it will be even more difficult to bridge this learning gap. So how do we navigate it? And how do we ensure that these children have an equal learning opportunity? In our following session on Reaching the Unreached, Empowering Remote Geographies, we'll be exploring the answers to these questions. To shed light on this and explore the way forward, we'll be joined by three ecosystem leaders, and it's my pleasure to introduce them to you. Our first panelist is Ms. Vidya Shah, who's the Chief Executive Officer of Edelgift Foundation, the philanthropic initiative of Edelweiss Group. Over the last decade, she has steered the growth of Edelweiss's social investments to develop a strategic philanthropic organization. In addition to this, she also serves on the board of various prominent civil society organizations like Augusta International Foundation, Center for Social Impact and Philanthropy, and the Indian School of Public Policy. Our second panelist is Ms. Tanya Khera, who is the co-founder of Samantha Foundation. She has a master's in social work and has keen interest in working with women and adolescent girls. This passion of hers has led her to identify different problems in varied contexts, and now she's working towards developing interlinkages of education with child and mother. Through Samantha, she's weaving a fabric around it in the hope of ensuring access to a holistic education for all. And our final panelist for this session is Ms. Saldan Sal, who's the co-founder of Arzamba. She started her career in medicine, but soon changed her path and shifted to the social development sector. She's an American India Fellowship alumni and has worked with Cavalier Education Foundation prior to starting Arzamba. With her belief in bridging the learning gaps in Kargil, she envisions every child as part of the education process. At this point of time, I would also like to tell our audience that towards the end of this session, we will open it for a Q&A round. So requesting all of you to share your questions in the Q&A box, which is at the bottom of your screen. And we will be taking up those questions after the conversation. So without taking any further time, I would like to invite all our panelists for the discussion and request Tanya to commence this session by sharing her thoughts on what reaching the unreached actually means. Over to you, Tanya.
Thank you, Parul, for this wonderful introduction. So the idea of reach for me is generally understood by three variables: access, availability, and affordability. Any of these variables at any given point in time can define what the idea of reach exactly is. We all live within a nation with world-class cities where everything is available at a touch of a finger, and there are still spaces where the sheer idea of communicating or getting connected is dependent upon human interaction. This is how a forest looks like, a place within limited access, availability of resources. Reach is also impacted by what bridge we build, and contextual education is one of the most essential components of that bridge. Context includes the language, geography, and lifestyle of the people we work with. Samantha works with the forest communities in the peripheral region of the Lower Shivaliks, in and around the Rajaji National Park and Tiger Reserve. These areas are exclusively under the jurisdiction of the Forest Department, with say no whatsoever of the state system, as a result of which there are no government facilities available for the people, such as there is no electricity, there is no pipe water supply, and any other services of that sort available for people. That's how the idea of access, availability, and affordability is built in this very ecosystem. We have been working towards building contextual solutions whose roots we believe lie in education. We work with two communities, one Gujjar and Tongians, with a history of pastoralism, owning livestock, working on small jobs for Forest Department since the colonial times. So when we first started working in the year 2018, so we came across multiple challenges. Initially, it was really difficult for us to bring the child to the school and also to build community trust with regards to sending the children to the forest school due to constant threat of wild animals and topography, as traveling a distance of 1 kilometer in a forest is much more complex than traveling the same distance in a rural area. At the same time, it was difficult to create a sense of acceptance of whatever the system was offering to the people. So to overcome these challenges, we followed or we took a few steps. Initially, our presence in the school led to regularity and equal attention to the one Gujjar children who were very new to the school. Also, we worked with all the stakeholders, from parents to the forest department, to the line staff, everybody, and worked on building the possibilities to bring the child to the school. So based on the community discussions, we built a sibling partnership wherein elder sibling was supposed to take care of the younger sibling, and also the children to travel in groups. So they walk from their house till the forest school in a group, and the one Gujjar meant to take care of the children while they go out till the highway to sell the milk. By us being in the school, we also focused on the narrative of context when we started discussing the Gujjari vocabulary. So Gujjari is a dialect. So it is not a written script. So we used the Devanagari script. And considering that, we took help from the community youth, the elders,
parents on board, and everybody, they came up, they voluntarily supported us in building the contextual literature book. And slowly and gradually, after a few months, we came up with a vocabulary bank. And through that vocabulary bank, we made a Hindi Varnmala book in Gujri. So this is, for example, teaching ka kha ga for a child. So we never used ka se kabutar. We always use ka se kag. Kag in Gujri language means crow. So that was easy for child to connect from what is being taught in the school and what his life is and what language he uses. So we also focused on linking the mother with the child, which has also led to constant conversations within the community. And this is something we are still working on. So the communities we are working on, have always faced a systemic discomfort, as there is no coordination between the system and the people living there. So the nature of work in the conflict areas has not been substantively related to the work in the non-conflict areas. So by conflict here, we don't mean the armed conflict, but yes, the spaces where there has been a constant tussle between the system and the people for just basic rights. So our people, they're living in the forest since years, but still they have got no ownership right over a single leaf of the forest. And the idea of access, availability, and affordability is still far away from reality. Like Ladakh, struggling from being a state to union territory and to autonomy. So in these challenging circumstances, topography, tough winters, and a complete disconnect from the mainland for half a year, I would like my co-panelist Saldan, who is from Ladakh, to share her experiences on the idea of how does the status of unreached affect children in Kargil. Over to you, Saldan.
Thank you so much, Tanya, and hello, Vidyaji. Glad to share this platform today with both of you. Zamba means a bridge in Ladakhi, and Kargil, the reason behind Zamba's existence is one of the twin districts of Ladakh, Leh being the popular other. Our long freezing winters of almost 5 months caused blockade of the lone mountain pass connecting us to the rest of the country and world, and an airport which is literally 300 kilometers away from where I reside in Kargil. This forces most of the people here in a natural lockdown every year from December to April ending, or sometimes mid of May. During this time, schools have their long winter breaks, and this leaves the school active for hardly 5 to 6 months during the comparatively warmer months. And just for the information of the audiences today, more than 70% of the children in Kargil are enrolled across almost 557 government schools. So we began our journey of supporting school education in Kargil in the year 2015 with the School Health and Sanitation Initiative, where we also built a toilet for the girl students at one of the government schools at Dras. And it took us almost 5 months and double the amount we had in our hand to complete that program, that project. Jo ki mainland India mein maybe kahin jagah sirf mushkil se 1 lakh lagta, you know. And the reason kya tha ki a young boy who had picked arms was killed in Kashmir by the military. And which kind of, pushed the whole valley under a curfew-like situation, blocking the loans road, supplying us with the resources that we needed at that particular point of time. And this was a normal and predictable phenomena when we were a part of JNK, which kind of narrowed down our work time frame even more. We still persisted and put consistent efforts in developing a more robust whole school transformation program for government and community-run schools in Kargil, and decided to start a pilot in one of the schools in Silmore block in Kargil, starting from July 2019. Boom, August happened and Article 370 was abrogated, and Ladakh was given the status of a union territory, but under bracket, without legislation, which in no way made the unstable political and social dynamics better in any way in this part of the world. Majority of the Kargil was against this move by the center, and this kind of led to a curfew-like situation, closing the schools until October 2019. And for almost 5 months, Kargil didn't have any internet access at all. So can you imagine schools reopening again and exams are scheduled just a week or two away in November? What will the kids or teachers do, when they already have a narrow time frame in hand, which is now more constricted due to all the political and social equilibrium So many of the kids, they resort to cheating, and it leaves more than, you know, 50% of the higher secondary schools giving less than 50% pass results, or unme se bhi kuch schools giving zero passing percentage. And also not to forget to add on to all these challenges, the systemic loopholes seen elsewhere in the country, and also not having a proper teacher transfer policy. So everyone of on the audience, I guess everyone knows Kargil after the famous Kargil War of 1999. And it was not the only war. There were two more in 1960s and one in 1970s. All three of them pushing Kargil decades back in the, you know, developmental pace. And the whole nation is reminded of Kargil every year when Kargil Vijay Diwas is approaching, which is good, which is not bad at all. But wouldn't it be better if we, you know, go beyond and understand the challenges of the people through their narratives and through their lenses? For people living here, it has become normal, you know. Ye sare conflicts, ye sare political ghich pich, sabko aadat ho gayi hai. But it isn't normal and it shouldn't be. So Vidyaji, this is a burning question for a body like Zamba, and I'm sure for Samantha as well, that how do we share this broader narrative with the rest of the world? And what could be the best ways to let the rest of the country understand our challenges and also know that we are trying to do something good over here, but we always struggle for support. Vidyaji, over to you.
Ma'am, you're on mute.
Sorry. It's an absolute pleasure and privilege to be here with the both of you today on this spectacular platform, and to hear from you, you know, about the kind of challenges that, you know, you, Tanya, working in the in Shivalik Hills, and Saldan working, you know, in Ladakh. I know about some of the challenges in the Leh district, but this was also very, very enlightening to hear. And, you know, after hearing you, some of the work that, you know, we've tried to do in very rural tribal parts of Maharashtra, it kind of pales in comparison. And so I'll just sort of describe, out of all the work we do in education, I'm focusing today on the more and more geographies and the geographies that are really difficult to reach out to. And therefore, you know, there are four districts in Maharashtra that we picked up a few years ago, or 4 years ago to be precise, to work with two NGOs on the ground, Kaivalya, who I'm sure everybody's familiar with them, and Gyan Prakash Foundation. And we chose Parbhani, Nandurbar, Gadchiroli, and Amravati. Actually, we didn't choose. The government asked us to work there because they, you know, they're really backward in almost all human development indicators. But like you mentioned, I think the remoteness in sort of better industrialized states like Maharashtra comes with kind of three things. The tribal nature of these geographies brings in an issue of language of learning. And I'm sure you also have faced similar issues. Tribal languages are different from the, you know, the state language Marathi. The second is the issue of migration. There's large degrees of migration because of which, and children migrate with their parents in most cases. And they also migrate partly because the schools are not good enough to hold them back. So there is an economic issue, but there's also an issue of education. And the third issue is really around access. So in the monsoons, for example, there are schools after schools where you just can't reach them. You have to cross a really swollen river, you have to, you know, plow through forests. So these, you know, all these geographies come with some characteristics that are quite similar to some of the ones you've described. Of course, there's a lot more nuance as we've seen in what you spoke about. And I think the reason I think I would say we've been somewhat successful in improving learning outcomes, as our studies have shown, is I think the number one reason has been the role of that the communities played in owning responsibility for education. So our program is multi-tiered. So it starts with, you know, communities at the bottom, including the role of that grant panchayats can play in determining resource allocation for schools. And it goes up to the school system, which is the teachers and the principals and school management committees and libraries, etc. And then goes up through to the state system. So, the district education officers and the block education officers, the Kendra Pramukhs, as they're called, the cluster heads, as they're called here. So a lot of work has happened at the community level and at the school level, which has really helped us re-engage children. And in Maharashtra, while enrollment is not a problem, attendance continues to be a problem. And of course, learning outcomes also are a problem. So I think one of the things we've done is what role can communities play and what role can the school system play? And we've done, a lot of innovative work, which, we can obviously discuss not today on this platform. I think in the midst of COVID, what has actually happened is, these geographies were actually taken aback because COVID didn't really reach them. But the impact of COVID was that schools were shut, despite the fact that the incidence of the disease was not as strongly felt as it was, say, in Mumbai or Pune or other cities in Maharashtra. And I think, again, the work that our NGOs on the ground really did was to engage the communities to find solutions for themselves. Both of you would have heard in the midst of this, everybody said, let's get online, let's get, students to use smartphones. And the reality of it is that that is really not possible in the geographies we work. And it's not just an internet issue or a phone issue. It's, these are all first generation learners whose parents cannot sit with them. They don't have a phone, among 2, 3, 4 children. They don't have that kind of, access. So we have to find newer ways of re-engaging. So the way NGOs, our partners got doing it is actually first looked at it as a health issue and used that to re-engage with communities to provide ration or to provide help, even though that was not their primary activity. And the second thing is to say, how do we get children in safe spaces to get them to learn on their own or with the help of teachers that we could re-engage? But a lot of that had to happen outside of the state system because it so happened that in the midst of COVID, it was kind of very close to schools shut down in Maharashtra in the early part of April. So this was, sort of coincided with schools shutting down as well. But the role that communities and frontline workers from our NGOs, they have played has actually gone quite uncelebrated in the last 4 or 5 months. And the role they played by using access to communities for rations and for health services and for midday meals replacements, I think that served as a good segue into finding the right solutions. The solutions aren't there still. They're still not there. We still don't know how things are going to evolve. But at least there is a move to realize that this is important. Schools will reopen in June in Maharashtra. But, what do we do? That thinking has really fast-forwarded. The use of libraries where possible, the safe places has begun, but we're really far away from a solution. So I'd like to sort of use this point to turn back to you, Tanya, as well as Saldam, to really understand what's happened in your geographies in the midst of the crisis.
So for Samantha, taking your words forward, I would say that initially during the early days of COVID, we took preemptive measures and asked our community to first track the travel history of people coming and going from the region. So we asked people to self-report and opt for quarantine to control the spread of disease. So initially in the early April, I would say we had 3 COVID positive cases in the forest and almost 200 people got quarantined. So by the end of April and early May, everyone was back home and healthy with no lives lost. And also while tracking the history, getting people quarantined, we also noticed that there were a lot of rumors going on due to the lack of information. So there were instances when we have been told by people that if they test positive for COVID, so they'll be injected with poison to kill the virus inside them. So we were just shocked to listen to such things. So what we did, we just planned, okay, it is very important for us to respond with correct information to counter such false news. Considering this, we created a contextual COVID workbook, and it is a 4-piece learning module which could be easily done by the youth with children and people around. And the workbook was centered around playing and learning. So while we were engaging with the community, we also saw that the challenges of health for women and adolescent girls were amplifying. So to overcome these challenges, we came up with the idea of hygiene kit for women. And COVID also impacted the livelihood for both our communities, as Tongiers lost their daily wage work, and Vangujas were unable to sell milk due to their restrictions on movement and due to lockdown norms. So we enabled the community to link up with the government schemes to get connected with PDS system, avail ration, and also get the traveling passes for milk, as milk is an essential item and they can easily go and sell it and get direct money transfers. So these small steps created a basic, I would say, support system for the community. So while we were able to work on the COVID challenges, in the post-quarantine phase in early May, we were having conversations with the parents that the constant disconnect from the school will lead to loss of learning for the child. And there has to be some engagement at the level of child. So this is where our youth and context played a very important role. As a follow-up to this, we designed contextual practice worksheets for the children. And in this, we prepared a framework and decided to share one set of worksheet over a period of 2 to 3 weeks. For this, we had on board our remote volunteers who had been engaged with us since early April and helped us create these worksheet bank. It also got connected to the learning, as in the long run, we are developing a thematic forest curriculum. And we always had this vision that in building a contextual literature in which the thematic forest curriculum will be a key driving force, and which we really intend to scale with time over and over the region. And this has been a constant endeavor since last year. All these helped us to quickly respond towards learning gap that was built in the time of COVID. So COVID came up with this opportunity for us, wherein we utilized this time for designing these worksheets and based on the thematic forest curriculum. But despite the challenges of traveling, we managed to reach our community by getting systemic permissions based on our trust with the line staff of the forest department, the actual ground staff. So all the stakeholders, they all came forward, supported us. And with this support, we created a supply chain for sending the learning kits to the children. So from one spot on the outskirts of the city, a man who's coming out to sell milk, we gave the learning kits to that person. He then took it and gave it to a shopkeeper on the highway. That person gave it to a forest guard. And from that forest guard, a youth from the community picked it up and he just gave it to the children. And this is how our efforts reached the children, and they really enjoyed it. They had fun doing it, fun understanding what COVID is. So this was just a brief of what we did and plan to do in the coming times. Now over to you, Saldan.
Thanks. This COVID situation actually has, you know, extended our already existing winter lockdown. And abhi winters December mein school band hue hain, and it's now we have entered into August, and it's almost 8 months complete, the schools are still not open and children are missing on the schooling. And to add to all these problems, the poor telecom connectivity to most part of rural Ladakh, like elsewhere in India. So surely, like, and jaise Vidya ji abhi bol rahi thi, surely the online teaching thing, the TV, the radio thing is not working for most of the students out here. And like every other year, you know, we had our plans for this year, ki is saal kuch acha karenge, kuch zyada karenge, but then COVID happened. And then now it was the time for us to think through and see that what are the best possible ways in, you know, to support our community with the least possible resources on our hands. So we began by doing a donation drive for supporting the local administration and the hospitals in the initial phase of the COVID infection spread. Jabki sare stocks khatam ho rahe the, market mein bhi, hospital mein bhi. So we provided PPE kits, sanitizers, sanitization devices to the hospitals, and even we collaborated with village youths to do village sanitization drives wherever they were required. And just like Tanya, you said, there were various myths, you know, and fake news is spreading at that time like fire. So we took that opportunity to make awareness related videos in our local dialect to be shared with the general public. Apart from that, for us, storytelling was the easiest and the strongest tool for ensuring social emotional well-being of the children and adults alike. Hence, we tried reaching out to those who had some kind of internet access through collaborative storytelling initiative called Room Room Cell, wherein storytellers from not just India and Ladakh, but from all over the world are sharing their stories and folklores with the kids and people over here through our social media platforms. So we also realized this COVID situation as an opportunity to make the best of the time we have right now in our hands to involve the school heads and teachers in trainings and workshops and interactions. Therefore, we joined hands with the district education office in Kargil with a mission to engage them so that they would be prepared for dealing with bringing their schools on feet after the lockdown, and also in a way ensuring sustainability of what Zamba intends to do in the schools in Kargil. Ladakh has also witnessed a reverse migration of professionals and students working and studying elsewhere in the nation to their hometowns and their villages during this COVID crisis. And we thought that why not to leverage their time, skills, and passion, you know, to reach out to children on their doorsteps. Therefore, we have come up with an initiative called Kharsa Yontan, which actually, you know, translates into a door-to-door project-based learning initiative through volunteer facilitators. And as of now, about 50 volunteers have already registered with us and from Leh and Kargil alike, and they are ensuring that learning continues to as many kids as possible they are able to reach right now. Yes, sir. बोल के भी लाइक ये सब तो ठीक है हम कर रहे हैं जितना भी कर रहे हैं बट वी नो दैट वी कैन डू मोर एंड वी कैन इम्पैक्ट मोर लाइव्स पॉजिटिवली बट व्हाट एक्चुअली स्टॉप्स ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस लाइक अस इन दीज यू नो ज्योग्राफीज एंड सिचुएशंस इज द फाइनेंशियल कंस्ट्रेंट वी नीड मोर मनी टू यू नो बी कंसिस्टेंट टू सस्टेन नॉट जस्ट आवर इनिशिएटिव्स बट ऑल्सो आवर ओन पर्सनल पैशन एंड फायर टू you know, give back to our communities. So Vidyaji, this makes me, and I'm sure Tanya here too, and to put out the bigger question out onto this platform today, that how to ensure, financial support to organization like ours, when most of the money in the ecosystem is directed either to urban locations or to more experienced and bigger organizations with bigger teams, or to people who can show numbers in a short interval of time, which is not at all possible in situation like ours with so many challenges. Hello. So it would be great, and Vidyaji, if you could shed some light on that.
I think there is some technical glitch at man's side. We can wait for a minute more.
Okay. In the meantime, we can go ahead with a few questions, and let's see. So the question is, these remote geographies are under systemic constraints. In your experience, what does it take to build hope in these regions, even at a small scale? So Saldan, would you like to?
Can you please repeat the question, Tanya?
Yeah, ma'am. Okay. Vidya, ma'am, she has joined.
Okay, I'm really sorry. I don't know what happened. No, I'll quickly answer the fundraising question because I'm sure you want time for questions. I think one of the things we've tried to do at Edelgave is right from the beginning really focused on building the capacity, finding and identifying great small and medium-sized organizations. That's what really we've been focused on, because we really believe that these are the organizations that tend to be closest to the communities that they serve, and therefore are best placed to find the solution. Having said that, I think the issue of funding is just so universal today across the sector. There are issues like education, which get a lot more funding than other sectors. But like you've mentioned, that give is very, very skewed towards larger organizations, as well as towards more urban organizations. And I think the CSR mandate has possibly skewed that even more, partly because corporates have taken it upon themselves to really focus on the geographies in which their factories exist or their offices exist. So even though education gets a bulk of the overall funding, that funding is very, very skewed. And therefore, I find that, organizations like yours, and I know a few other organizations in Ladakh as well, Sardan, who really, really struggle. There is an issue of getting to funders. There is an issue of, pushing the cause. There is an issue of making the cause relevant to people who live far away and don't really experience the challenges that you do. So unfortunately, other than really finding platforms like these, as well as using, the convening power of a lot more strategic and a lot more forward-looking funders to actually evangelize your cause, I really don't see any other way. I'm seeing, for example, we work in education, but we also work in gender justice. And, the overall pie, out of the overall pie, 3% goes to gender justice issues. So there's a lot of inequality, even in the way the funding gets transmitted. One of the things funders like us also do is find and help organizations like yours diversify your source of funding. So for example, we have, as of last year, we had 71 grants that we made to 42 organizations. Out of those 70, we found co-funding for 50. So we fund, but we bring other people along as well. So that's one solution, is to find good core funders and then piggyback on their ability to get other funders also together. And the second thing is, how do you make the cause more, the cause is very real, it's very important, it's very urgent, but it's not, it doesn't get to people's heart. And unfortunately, bridging that emotional gap is also very important. And a lot of that happens through PR, through communication, through convenings, through using as many platforms as possible. So there's no real easy solution, but I think there are ways out there to connect with people and make the cause very, very real to them.
Yeah. So thank you for this wonderful and crisp answer to the very important question on the funds for the communities working in the unreached areas. So to conclude what we had discussed, so drawing from the conversations today, we look at reach from an access, affordability and availability lens. Access being a matter of geography and narrative, affordability determined by the ability of the community and interest of the system. Availability is a matter of systemic support and limitations of resources, for initiatives by organizations like us working in remote geographies. Context for communities living in forest and Kargil plays a very important role as and we have adopted our work in the area of education for learning and sustainable outcomes. COVID has highlighted how our established notions of education have been challenged due to limited preparedness, infrastructure, and resources. At the same time, it has also brought for organizations like us working in remote geographies to innovate and respond. We have come up with various ideas of learning kits, storytelling, worksheets, etc., to keep the engagement alive and lamp burning. We have made our efforts and carry on to do so. We look forward to sharing and engaging with more organizations, individuals, and efforts across our esteemed audience in coming times. We hope these partnerships and collaborations lead to strengthening of our work with children and enhance scale and impact. We thank Vidya, team Edumentum, and Mantra for this opportunity and sharing experience and engaging with this lovely audience. So now I open the session for questions and answers. So this question is for Vidya. What are the key points you keep in mind when you decide to invest in a social organization?
Yeah, so we work in three areas. We work in education, we work in livelihoods, rural livelihoods, largely orientated towards water and agriculture. And the third is in gender justice, specifically in the empowerment of women and girls through a social and economic lens. So we have a sort of a grant cycle. We are a long-term funder. We tend to make grants of 2 to 3 years at the very least. And we are a long-term funder in large parts of our portfolio. We have organizations that we've engaged with for over 6 to 7, sometimes 8, 10 years as well. Our focus is on small and medium-sized organizations where, budgets tend to be between, so it's not extreme start, it's not a very startup, but it's at probably, 3, 4, 5 years down the line. So it's between, say, $500,000, so about a crore, a couple of crores right through to 8-10 crores is our sweet spot in terms of our in terms of the annual budget. And then, I think it's for us, the most important thing is the leader and the team, and then the program and the thought around the theory of change. And also, what has been, the strength of the program. Because we also focus on capacity building, there are lots of things that we also fund that usually people don't fund. So we do fund beyond program costs. We do fund a lot of HR costs, team building costs, sometimes just, building the costs of HR or administration or finance, and also help in developing systems and processes. So for us, the leader and the team, as well as the program and the strength of the program is really important.
Thank you. We can take another question. So these remote geographies are under systemic constraints. In your experience, what does it take to build hope in these regions, even at a small scale? Mm-hmm. So Seldon, either you and me both can go ahead with this, share our experience.
मैं जवाब तो क्या मतलब होप दीज रीजन्स इतने चैलेंजेस हैं यहाँ पे और स्टिल पीपल आर सर्वाइविंग एंड एक तरह से चैलेंजेस के साथ लोग रेजिलियंट भी बन जाते हैं एंड उम्मीद पे ही तो दुनिया कायम है तो लोग वहाँ पे उम्मीद पे ही कायम है बेसिकली सो इवन इफ समवन इज डूइंग अ स्मॉल जेस्चर ऑल्सो इट इज लाइक अ वेरी गुड थिंग फॉर देम छोटा सा किसी को कुछ आप कोई वर्कशॉप ही छोटा सा करा लोगे सो इट्स अ गुड इट्स अ बिग थिंग फॉर देम कि हाँ कुछ हो रहा है स्पेशली व्हेन यू एंगेज विद किड्स अगर बच्चों को थोड़ा सा भी कुछ नया सीखने को मिलता है दे आर सो हैप्पी सो व्हेन आई ऑलवेज शेयर दिस पर्टिकुलर एग्जांपल जैसे कि मैंने अपने उसमें भी बोला था कि बच्चों के पास टाइम बहुत कम होता है बट स्टिल कि एग्जाम्स के लिए प्रिपेयर करने का ढंग से टाइम नहीं मिलता उनको बट दे स्टिल कम टू गिव देयर एग्जाम्स which which gives, you know, which shows the hope that they have. They know that they might fail. They know that, you know, they might, you know, exams mein wo paar nahi kar payenge, but still they come and give their papers, you know, which is the biggest, you know, ray of hope. Mujhe to lagta hai, wo mujhe hope dete hai. The kids, they give hope to us to, nahi, jab wo itna lage hue hain, to why shouldn't we, you know, why shouldn't we keep on pushing for the cause and do something more for the kids over there. So I think hope is there. Wahan pe hame kisi ko hope dene ki zarurat nahi hai. Unse hame hope khud bahut zyada milta hai. Especially in a location like Kargil, you know, jahan pe jange ho gayi hai, itna sara political or geographical, itne sare challenges hain. But still the people are resilient and they are hopeful for the better future. Everyone is striving for it. So we are just trying to, you know, contribute our bit into that. So yeah, that's what I think.
Yeah. And for us, if I would take this forward, for us, I completely agree with what Saldan shared, that hope is what we get from people, and then we get a lot of energy to work and share, be there. So commitment is one thing that we get, that, okay, people are with us, we have to work. And also another hope example I would take, that valuing the indigenous knowledge. So if we go from a mindset that we are the ones ki hame sab pata hai, so that becomes a little challenging. So, but when we value, okay, your knowledge is something very important, and we value the community leadership. So that builds a lot of hope. And and also children are such a good source of hope. Every time we go, so they don't greet us like namaste and all, wo hamare upar chadh jaate hain. And then you feel that connect. What else do we want in life? Like every morning you see such bright faces and some pretty girls, like jo kabhi, they were not even allowed to come to school. And I remember a young girl, her name is Asma. So she was not allowed to come to school. Wo subah bhi apne bahut choti si hai, she was washing utensils. And then we had conversations with her parents that isko bhi bhejo, isko bhi padhayenge, her brother is coming, they'll all come, main unko pick karne aungi, andar tak jaungi. So they were like, theek hai. So I used to walk and bring her to the school, and now she is like flourishing. Like we always say, ki tumhara naam Asma hai and you will touch the sky. So she is coming out with bright colors. So yeah, hope is everywhere, all around. So yeah, and we don't have any more questions, do we? Yeah, so we have got another question. So Parul, can we take, or we have just crossed the limit?
Yeah, so so I think we are short on time.
Okay.
Yeah.
No matter.
But we can always take these questions offline and, you know, do another sort of session like this.
Yeah. Thank you.
Great. So thank you so much, Tanya, Saldan, and Vidya, for such an enlightening conversation. It is interesting to learn about different challenges and opportunities in the remote geographies. And I'm pretty sure with organizations like Samantha and Arzamba, there are many other organizations working in this context, and their collective action will ensure that no child is left out of the learning experience. It's definitely encouraging to be reminded of the possibilities and opportunities that are present in remote geographies and how organizations can leverage them to move forward. So thanks a lot to all our panelists for joining us today and sharing such insightful experiences. Thank you. And with this, I would also like to remind our viewers to fill the Google form shared with you in the chat box if you would like to connect with these organizations. Okay. While in our last conversation, we talked about how geographical access is a key factor in influencing how children learn, there are also other factors that stand in the way for children to getting access to quality education. We all have heard the quote that children are the real victims of war, and to extend it further, we would like to say that children are the real victims of war and poverty. They do not only affect access to education, but also pose a threat to childhood, exposing children to human trafficking, child labor, and being militarized. Their childhood is lost before they even begin to take shape, and with this, they are heading farther from the promise of education. So, In a challenging environment like this, what role can civil society organizations play? In our next conversation about saving childhood through education, we'll be exploring this further with our panel. It's a pleasure to introduce our first panelist for this session, Ms. Anshu Bhartia, who is the CEO of Unlimited India. She's passionate about mentoring social impact organizations and is keen on supporting them in scaling their idea and impact. She believes in leveraging the power of new potential change makers through enabling, supporting, and building the social entrepreneurship ecosystem, leading to exponential impact. Our second panelist is Mr. Ashish Srivastav, who is the co-founder of Shikshart. He's an engineer by qualification and teacher by profession. He's a TFI alumni and also an Acumen Fellow. With over 16 years of work experience, he leads Shikshart with the belief of service with solution. And our last panelist for the day is Mr. Ashwini Tiwari, who's the co-founder of Vidyalaya Udyam. He's an engineer by education and a social worker by profession. He's a Gandhi Fellowship alumni and has previously worked with Medha Learning Foundation. He's passionate about working with young learners to solve complex problems with simple solutions. At this point, I would again like to remind our viewers that this session will be open for Q&A round post the conversation. So requesting all of you to please put your questions in the Q&A box, which is at the bottom of your screen. And moving ahead, I would like to thank our panelists for joining us and would request Ashish to open the session by sharing what childhood looks like in such challenging situations. Over to you, Ashish.
Thank you, Parul. Good evening, everybody. In a grade 4 classroom with 63 children, when asked to sketch at free will, 47 students sketched the scene of a combat situation where the pictures contained gunfights, violence, blasts, security forces killing tribals, and vice versa. That classroom is in Sukma, and the children are from tribal communities. Sukma is a tribal district with dense forest in the central India, in the state of Chhattisgarh, and has seen destruction since the last two plus decades because of left-wing extremism, commonly known as Naxal violence, Maoist violence. We work with such children and come across these stories of troubled childhood every day, be it a Hirma who has once been part of the children's wing of the Naxal militia, or Roshan who ran out of his home to study, or Geeta whose father was killed by the local community members and Naxal supporters on the suspicion of being a police informer. While conflict in any part of the world brings in destruction, poverty, poor human development indicators, it is the children and the women who are the most affected, and it takes generations for them to come out of it. Well, Sukma is not alone. The country, one-fourth of the country is affected by this conflict, covering states like Jharkhand, Odisha, Telangana, Andhra, Maharashtra, Bihar, and with 1.2 crore children at risk. Over here, if I have to talk about Sukma in specific, the children deal with three core issues. Access to safe spaces and a safe childhood. Access to school and access to quality learning opportunities. They have been growing up in an environment which is full of fear, mistrust, violence, pain. And with all these scenarios, the probability of them choosing violence as a means is an unfortunate reality on a daily basis. In the last decade, more than 300 schools have gone dysfunctional, destroyed because of the conflict. And 20,000 plus children have either dropped out of school or have not been able to have the fundamental access to school education. So we often say that every book dropped here is a bullet booked, is a bullet picked up in the region. Our work with conflict-affected children has helped us realize that every child deserves a childhood of peace and compassion, which becomes our primary objective of existence as an organization. And also, education is a fundamental right beyond any ideological conflict. I would like to invite Ashwini to share about childhood and how does the life of children look like in his area in Rajasthan. He too has been working with tribal children and dealing with issues of sustenance and livelihood. Ashwini, it would be great if you could share your experience.
Thanks, Ashish ji. Namaste, Anshu ma'am, and great evening to everyone. As we are working in South Rajasthan, basically a tribal region, specifically in Udaipur district. So आज हम childhood और education की बात कर रहे हैं. Normally जब हम लोगों से interact होते हैं, हम पूछते हैं कि जब आप बचपन शब्द या childhood शब्द ऐसा सुनते हैं तो क्या image आपके दिमाग में बनती है. 90% लोग जवाब देते हैं कि कुछ स्कूल जाते हुए बच्चे, आपस में खेलता हुआ एक छोटा सा बच्चों का ग्रुप, या एक जॉयफुल चेहरा. ये भी एग्जिस्ट करता है, बट इन 30% पार्ट ऑफ जो ट्राइबल ज्योग्राफी है, ग्राउंड जीरो पे ये सिचुएशन बहुत अलग है. एक एग्जाम्पल है, हम हर साल जब भी यहाँ परीक्षाएं होती हैं, हम एक सिचुएशन से गुजरते हैं. जब भी बच्चा यहाँ आठवीं का या दसवीं का बोर्ड दे रहा होता है तो गांव में एक नारा गूंजता है, या तो पास नहीं तो अहमदाबाद. यहाँ अहमदाबाद वो एक छोटा सा एक जो बड़ा शहर अहमदाबाद हो आप वो मत समझिएगा, भारत में ऐसे हजारों अहमदाबाद हैं. ये फेमस हैं जहाँ बच्चे कम दाम में और हार्ड वर्क करने के लिए कम पैसों पे चले जाते हैं, काम करते हैं. नॉर्मली जब आप भी अपने घरों से निकलते होंगे, शहरों में भी आप ये देखते होंगे कि छोटे छोटे जो छोटू हैं, जिनको हम नॉर्मली बुलाते हैं, वो आपको दिखते होंगे. कौन है ये कहाँ से आते हैं? ये शहरों से भी आते हैं और ये ज्यादातर हमारे ग्रामीण और इस ट्राइबल रीजन से भी आते हैं. जब भी हम पेरेंट्स से मिलते हैं, हम कहते हैं भाई आप ऐसा डायलॉग ऐसा नारा क्यों लगाते हैं जब भी ऐसा होता. वो कहते हैं कि जब 12वीं पढ़ के भी हमारे बच्चे को ऑटो रिक्शा ही चलाना है, ठेला चलाना है, मजदूरी करना है, तो ये 8वीं के बाद 4 साल क्यों बर्बाद करें. तो हम उसको भेजते हैं और ये साइकिल कंटिन्यू होती है. ज्यादातर लोग बोलते हैं कि ये एक इकोनॉमिक क्राइसिस की वजह से होता है, उस फैमिली की इनकम कम है. हम जब नजदीक से देखते हैं तो ये इकोनॉमिक कम, लेकिन रेजिलियंस का स्कोप ज्यादा दिखता है हमको. रेजिलियंस इसके पीछे की सबसे बड़ी वजह हमको दिखती है. 4 बच्चे तो निकलते हैं, लेकिन 6 की भीड़ उनके पीछे वो रिपल इफेक्ट की तरह जाती, वो दोस्ती में चली जाती है, या वो गांव में एंगेज होने की अपॉर्चुनिटी नहीं है इसलिए चली जाती. भाई ये सारी पिक्चर ग्लूमी नहीं है. हमारे पास ऐसे पोटेंशियल वाले बच्चे भी हैं जो अपने गांव की ही प्रॉब्लम को आइडेंटिफाई करते हैं, उसको सॉल्व करते हैं और एक बिजनेस के रूप में उसको गांव के साथ मिलकर स्केल भी करते हैं. आज हमारे साथ इस कन्वर्सेशन की आगे कड़ी में अंशु मैम भी हैं. अंशु मैम इंडिया की वन ऑफ द लार्जेस्ट यंग लोगों के साथ काम करने वाली इंक्यूबेशन हब की संस्थापक हैं, सीईओ हैं. इनको यंग लोग, मैम आपको यंग लोगों के साथ काम करने का बहुत लंबा एक्सपीरियंस रहा है. इट विल बी अ ग्रेट अपॉर्चुनिटी फॉर अस कि आप चाइल्डहुड और एडुकेशन में हम और क्या संभावनाएं हैं, हम क्या इसमें और नया कर सकते हैं उस पर शेयर करें. सो ओवर टू अंशु मैम.
थैंक यू आशीष अश्वनी. मतलब हम तो इंक्यूबेटर हैं जो आप जैसे डायनामिक पीपल के साथ काम करते हैं. इट्स ऑलवेज हम्बलिंग टू हियर यू. इट्स हम्बलिंग टू हियर द सिचुएशंस इन विच यू आर वर्किंग. आई एम ट्रूली इंस्पायर्ड. दैट्स व्हाट गॉट मी टू अनलिमिटेड, बिकॉज हम आपके जैसे बहुत सारे नॉट मिसली यंग, हमारे 50-year-old एंटरप्रेन्योर्स भी हैं, बट दे आर फर्स्ट टाइम एंटरप्रेन्योर्स. सो यंग इन द स्कोप ऑफ एंटरप्रेन्योरशिप के साथ हम सपोर्ट करते हैं. पिछले पैनल ने भी बोला कि अनफॉर्चुनेटली द स्क्यू ऑफ एजुकेशन फंडिंग इज मोर टुवर्ड्स लार्ज ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस एंड टुवर्ड्स अर्बन, जो हम भी थोड़े हद तक अपने इंक्यूबेटर में पहले देखते थे. हमने भी बहुत प्रयास अब यह करना शुरू किया है कि हम कैसे टीयर टू टीयर थ्री रूरल में जो जिनके पास उतना एक्सेस नहीं है टू सपोर्ट, हम उनके पास कैसे पहुंचे, एंड वी आर इंक्रीजिंग आवर नेटवर्क. बट आई थिंक ये टॉपिक एक तो बहुत ही गहरा है, इट्स वेरी कॉम्प्लेक्स. आशीष ने कॉन्फ्लिक्ट की बात की, अश्विनी आपने लाइवलीहुड्स की बात की, और एक तरफ से सोशल प्रेशर भी है, ये लड़कियों पे ज्यादा भारी पड़ता है. फर्स्ट इंस्टेंस पे लड़कियों को बोल दिया जाता है स्कूल ना जाओ, और जो जाती भी हैं उनके साथ इवन इन द अर्बन लैंडस्केप इतने सारे चैलेंजेस होते हैं कि दे आर फोर्स्ड टू ड्रॉप आउट. सो इफ आई राउंड दिस ऑल अप, प्रॉब्लम्स बहुत है. वी आर ऑल अराउंड दिस टेबल, मोस्ट ऑफ अस हैव बीन वर्किंग ऑन सम ऑफ दिस प्रॉब्लम्स, सम ऑफ देम आर स्टिल टू बी टैकल्ड. अब इस पे एक और लेंस डाल दीजिए, डिसेबिलिटीज. तो आप अगर यू आर अ चाइल्ड विद एनी काइंड ऑफ डिसेबिलिटी, आप और भी मार्जिनलाइज हो जाते हैं इसमें, राइट? सो हमने जो सो आई थिंक वी वर्क विद 172 एंटरप्रेन्योर्स, एंड जस्ट बिकॉज वी वर्क विद सो मेनी एंटरप्रेन्योर्स अक्रॉस द सेक्टर्स, एंड एजुकेशन हमारा सबसे लार्जेस्ट पोर्टफोलियो है. ऑलमोस्ट 40-50 हमारे एंटरप्रेन्योर्स एजुकेशन पे ही काम करते हैं, काफी अर्ली स्किलिंग पे करते हैं. कैन यू हियर मी? आई हैव गॉट अ नोटिफिकेशन माय स्पीकर्स नॉट वर्किंग. कैन यू हियर मी?
यस मैम, इट्स टोटली क्लियर.
ऑसम. सो आई थिंक मुद्दा बहुत कॉम्प्लेक्स है, काम हो रहा है एंड और काम चाहिए, एंड मे बी एट अ मच मोर स्टेप्ड अप पेस, राइट? सो द इंटरेस्टिंग पार्ट्स ऑफ ब्रिंगिंग चिल्ड्रन बैक टू एजुकेशन, एक है उनको स्कूल लाया जाए, सेफ स्पेस बनाया जाए जैसे आपने बोला आशीष, एक है उनको इंगेज कैसे करें ताकि बच्चे भी बोले कि नहीं हमें स्कूल जाना है, राइट? So what we see some very interesting initiatives on getting children to come to school, especially at least urban landscape mein to bahut chalta hai, where girls drop out. So how do you build their confidence? Is it through music? Is it through poetry? Is it through enhanced learning? Aajkal Pratham has partnered with one of our NGOs which works with music, and they've created a music curriculum which can engage children in rural India to understand their talents in music and build that as a skill. Right? So how do we create engagement where children will want to come to school? It's if it's very early childhood, right? So there is a lot of unique work happening there. Then you have work of people using sports to engage children and getting them out of their houses. In urban landscapes, it works more about night schools. Jaise aapne bola livelihood ke liye wo Ahmedabad bhej diye jaate hain, par agar wo Ahmedabad apni hi locality mein ho, to wo bacche din mein kaam kar sakte hain aur raat ko school ja sakte hain. Mumbai, ek Maharashtra is a state which has actually enabled night schools, and one of our NGOs, Masooms, works extensively in upgrading the quality of the night schools. So, kuch kuch humne aisa bhi dekha hai, jo bachche day school jaate hain, wo bhi us night school mein aate hain, kyunki unka learning enhance ho jata hai. So, I think then you have NGOs which are working on enabling government systems. Government ke bahut schemes hain to get children back into education. Right to education ke andar 25% children can get access to good schools. But underprivileged person ko kaise pata kaun sa form bharna hai, kahan jana hai, kaise dastavez karne hai. So there are NGOs helping people, two of our NGOs actually helping people get access to that education, either through policy changes or through forms. So I think the work is happening extensively. It is about getting them into school, getting them engaged, and then retaining them and increasing learning outcomes. And I think आप लोग को भी शायद आशीष अगर आपको ये चैलेंज आता है, बट हम बहुत देखते हैं जहाँ पे डायरेक्ट लर्निंग आउटकम रिलेटेड आउटकम नहीं है. जैसे मैं 21st century स्किल्स कर रही हूँ, अभी एक हियरिंग इम्पेयर्ड बच्चे को अगर मैं क्लासरूम में ले आऊँ जो सालों से बंद था अपने घर में क्योंकि उसके पास कोई कॉन्वर्सेशन के लिए नहीं था, अगर वो इंजॉय करने लगता है, हाउ डू आई क्वालिफाई इट, हाउ डू आई कैप्चर इट? So how do you capture the impact in a world which is very driven by impact? Outcome kya hai aapka? To ek jo hum challenge dekhte hain, jo bhi childhood early education mein kaam kar rahe hain, to not link to learning outcomes, how do they engage funders? How do they get money to grow? Right? So that's one challenge that we see. The other challenge is, that people ask for the long term impact. Ki wo kitne saal rahe hain? Agar R3 ke baad drop out ho jate hain, to phir kya fayda? So I think, there is work happening, there is great work happening. Incubators are very invested in the work, either by funding or supporting for-profits, jo thode paying customers ko service kar sakte hain, and NGOs unko service karte hain jo ekdam marginalized hain, jinke paas koi payment ka tarika nahi hai, NGOs work with them, right? So I think both the models are there. incubators are very invested. There is a future because a lot of work is happening, but a lot of work needs to happen. अभी एक और हमारे पास आगे समस्या आ रही है विद कोविड, बट अब व्हाट वी आर हियरिंग इज फोकस विल गो इनटू लाइब्रेरीज, तो उस पे एजुकेशन के फंडिंग पे पहले तो पैसे नहीं होंगे, और अगर सब लाइब्रेरीज और हेल्थ पे चले जाएंगे तो विल एजुकेशन सफर. सो आशीष, इट ब्रिंग्स मी टू द क्वेश्चन, आप एकदम एक रिमोट एरिया में काम कर रहे हैं, आई डोंट नो व्हाट द फंडिंग लैंडस्केप हैज बीन लाइक, हाउ चैलेंजिंग हैज इट बीन. अब कोविड के तहत do you see it being a worse challenge, and some of the good work you've done, will it get impacted, do you think?
Anshu ma'am, so jaise baki organizations ki halat hai, waise hamari bhi hai, bas thoda sa problem ya manifest ho jata hai. So we lost funds, donors bahut sare back out kar gaye, we had kyunki hum conflict zone mein hai to hum mostly to हमको इंस्टीट्यूशनल फंडिंग नहीं मिलती है यार, 80% ऑफ आवर फंड्स, 70 to 80% ऑफ आवर फंड्स कम फ्रॉम रिटेल फंड रेजिंग, क्राउड फंडिंग. सो अभी जब इकोनॉमी की हालत खराब है तो लोगों के पे हाइक्स नहीं हो रहे, तो ऑब्वियसली हमारा जो क्राउड फंडिंग है वो वीक हो गया है. ये तो है ही, उसके अलावा एक तो वैसे भी रिमोट लोकेशन है एंड मोस्ट ऑफ आवर टीम मेंबर्स दे आर फ्रॉम डिफरेंट पार्ट्स ऑफ द कंट्री, यहाँ पे हैं, अकेले हैं, सो द होल सोशियो इमोशनल वेलबींग ऑफ द टीम मेंबर्स इटसेल्फ is a challenge, and we have been taking pay cuts since March, around 50 to 75%, and that too when as a grassroots organization hamare compensation already bahut kam hote hain, I mean it's hardly in the range of 10 to 20,000, uspe bhi we have been taking pay cuts. So with 50% reduction in pay cuts, we hope that will survive the financial year, but situation after that looks difficult. Our operations have got impacted since we are unable to reach our students. Most of the students are back into their villages, which are deep inside the jungle and are difficult to reach, and they don't have any access to any kind of device or phone or network, so jana mushkil hai. And with this, the biggest threat is to the overall purpose of the organization, that with the schools closing in and the children being back in school with their villages, the probability that children will be dropping out and joining Naxal militia is very, very high. Usually, aise conflict areas mein, mostly education department mein, the residential schools zyada hote hain. 50% of the children are in residential schools. Sabhi residential schools band hain, sare bachche apne gaon mein, they are being brainwashed. Yeah, they are pursuing various livelihood opportunities. So, जितना दिन स्कूल बंद रहेगा, जितनी दिन वो डिस्कनेक्टेड रहेंगे, उतने ज्यादा चांसेस हैं कि they'll be impacted because of that violence. So, these are what is the immediate issues that we are facing with because of the COVID-19 situation. However, we believe that इस टाइम पे सर्वाइव करना ज्यादा जरूरी है, and also we are very unsure of how things will look like. Considering the fact that if we try to realign ourselves as an organization, for example with EdTech, abhi EdTech main realign karta bhi hu, lekin yahan to 95% bachcho ko EdTech ki opportunity nahi hai, to where do I realign with? Like everybody else in the sector, a lot of our peer organizations have started using technology, we can't use because it's of no use. Ek wo hai, but still we are trying to make our work more relevant for the children in these areas and create the solutions accordingly. The fact is also that uncertainty has been part of our daily life for the past 8 years. Every year in the month of April to June, hum aise baith ke soch rahe hote hain ki is saal kaam karne ko milega ya nahi milega, because of the socio-political ecosystem, hostile environment towards सिविल सोसाइटी ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस, लैक ऑफ सपोर्ट फ्रॉम स्टेक होल्डर्स, एक मतलब एक्सट्रीम एंड पे कभी कभी जाता है जहाँ पे कम्प्लीटली एंटी एनजीओ सेंटिमेंट होता है कि एनजीओस को गोली ही मार दें. दे वी हैव ऑफिसर्स हु थिंक दैट देयर इज नो डिफरेंस बिटवीन एनजीओस एंड तालिबान और अदर टेररिस्ट ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस. सो वी फेस दैट, सो दैट अनसर्टेनिटी इज ऑलवेज अ पार्ट ऑफ लाइफ. एंड विद दीस थिंग्स वी डिड हैव आवर ओन लर्निंग ऑन हाउ डू वी still bring in sustainable change in difficult geographies like Sukma, and 25% of India is in similar situations, jo geographically politically difficult hain. So one of the key belief system that we have developed is immersion hour project is the key to bring in sustainable change. So, I mean, a lot of us as organizations, we work in project modes where we execute for 2 years and sell the dreams for 20 years to the community. We'll bring in money, we'll bring in resources, influencers, सरकारी अधिकारियों का आदेश हम बहुत सारे प्रेशर और अथॉरिटी क्रिएट करके कुछ इम्पैक्ट ड्राइव करते हैं लेकिन द मोमेंट वी टेक एन एग्जिट इट कोलैप्सेस सो वी बिलीव दैट यू हैव टू बी कमिटेड एनफ टू ब्रिंग इन द सस्टेनेबल चेंज एंड यू हैव टू बी कमिटेड एनफ टू वर्क योर वर्क शुड स्पैन अक्रॉस डिकेड्स आई मीन एंड हेंस योर आउटकम फ्रेमवर्क्स योर प्रोग्राम डिजाइन योर स्ट्रेटजीज शुड रियलाइन सो Empirically, we take 3 years to achieve the kind of impact that our peer organization does in 1 year. It's a simple 1:3 ratio. But then we have kind of accepted with that fact, so we kind of don't compete or we don't get our heads stressed out because of the fact that we are not able to deliver that impact. It takes time in these areas. And second most important thing is the attitude toward community. A lot of us talk about us and them. And we say it's not us and them, it's all us. Hum bhi usi problem ka hissa hai. And usi solution ka bhi hissa hai. So proximity to the problem for us is a key aspect of our work. And we say that we can't look at problem as an outsider. It has to be as an insider. Which implies that what might be a problem as per the social... development norms, it is not a problem for the tribal communities at all. I mean, there's a very interesting example when we started our work in this region. Hum kuch nahi karte the, hum school mein jaate the, and we would simply observe what all is happening. And teachers had come up with issues jo generally kisi educational startup ke mandate mein hi nahi hai. So they said, ki sir, hamara morning assembly conduct karwa dijiye. 20 minute ka morning assembly. या दस या स्कूल का टाइम टेबल बना दीजिए अभी अगर मैं एज एन ऑर्गेनाइजेशन बोलता हूँ कि मेरा मैंडेट मॉर्निंग असेंबली और स्कूल का टाइम टेबल कंडक्ट करना है सो आई विल नॉट गेट फंडेड बट द प्रॉब्लम इज दिस इज व्हाट द स्टेक होल्डर वांट्स टू व्हाट वांट्स आवर हेल्प ऑन दे डोंट वांट हेल्प ऑन द स्कूल ट्रांसफॉर्मेशन एंड ऑल दैट स्टफ सो आई थिंक द एबिलिटी टू लिसन एंड ऑब्जर्व इज अ की एस्पेक्ट एंड we move towards achieving both these objectives through systemic action. We collaborate with the administration, with the community. And the idea is to come without any authority. Gandhi Fellowship, jo program usme, they use this phrase and I like it very in influence without authority. Hum yahan pe kehte hain ki leadership when you are a nobody. I don't belong to Chhattisgarh. I'm from Lucknow. 2012 mein ghumte ghumte pahunch gaya tha. So we don't have a CSR backing or an IS officer backing, or I'm not a native. None of my team members are native of this area. So what does leadership look like when you are a nobody? So humse to log poochte hain ki aap itne acche the to yahan kyun aa gaye? So ye ek hai. And we believe that ye jo stakeholders ke saath collaborate karna hai, isme how much are you willing to lose your individual identity and go towards collective identity? So this is what... we know, and I would like to know, based on your experience, I mean, from Unlimited India and your past experiences as well, ki system mein, where does the opportunities lies according to you to leverage? Chahe wo abhi COVID-19 ki samasya ho, ya in general, aise geographies mein, aise remote locations mein kaam karne ka ho.
Complicated hai. And you know, Ashish, I hear your pain. Like you said, ek to hai ki कम्युनिटी को क्या चाहिए और हम किस परस्पेक्टिव से आए और फंडर को क्या चाहिए आपके तीन की स्टेक होल्डर्स है आपकी कम्युनिटी है आपकी टीम है और आपके फंडर्स हैं अगर मैं उनको टीम में बकेट करता हूँ एंड अगर कम्युनिटी में मैं गवर्नमेंट को भी डाल दूँ राइट अब किसको क्या चाहिए दैट दे कैन बी सो कॉन्फ्लिक्टिंग एंड आई रियली लाइक योर गांधी फेलो एग्जाम्पल ऑफ सेइंग हाउ डू यू इन्फ्लुएंस विदाउट अथॉरिटी बट पहले समझे हम कि आपको क्या चाहिए एंड व्हाट विल मेक सेंस फॉर यू टू इवन गेट इनटू द सिस्टम राइट So I think our learnings are somewhat in some senses similar. Jo ek to jo kisi bhi maine mein successful ho paaye hain, it is because we learn to listen, right? But ab ek taraf hai community ke saath in relationship. I feel that's a little more easier because if you can win that trust, especially some examples, pilots demonstrated. आपको एक buy-in थोड़ा जल्दी मिल सकता है because I feel that's a stakeholder which is more willing if they see value and honesty, right? So एक तो है जो सिस्टम में घुसने का जो हम थोड़ा थोड़ा देख रहे हैं where people have watching in the community learn to leverage panchayat funds or local community funds because they see value. तो एक तो उसे बाहर आ जाता है सिस्टम में चेंज आ जाता है कहीं ना कहीं वो क्षमता होती है पर कंटिन्यू इवन बियॉन्ड यू राइट. The other some examples that they've been able through pilots to show to the government that you use your infrastructure to implement, we will be the thought leaders. We will raise money for that because the government won't pay you and your thought leadership. But can we raise that money from CSRs? Because CSRs ko wo number dikhte hain fir. But you be the front runner implementation. So I don't know if you heard of the happiness curriculum in Delhi. Right, it's across all the municipal schools of Delhi because the government bought into it. A collaboration of 3 or 4 NGOs came together to design the curriculum. They were funded from outside, but they're within the state ministry to implement it. Right, so ek tarah se aapki stakeholder community, which also can be a funding source. There is government to stretch your boundaries of implementation. The third one is one of your funders to become that instigator of collaboration and getting other people into your community to give that longevity. So jahan jahan dekhiye bahut complex projects hote bhi hain but ye humne kahin kahin early successes dekhe hain. Lender Hand has put its people in the government, then they're not an incubator but limited but they're good friends. So unhone kya kiya, government mein log place kar diye hain for vocational training in schools. So now the entire district administration will work with you because you're coming from the government, right? And I'm not saying any of this is easy, but community itself is your first, government, funders, and the other third one is partnership. So jaise hamari ek NGO hai, unhone Punjab government ne ek initiative kiya, so they were able to ride along with that initiative, saying, "Acha, aap ye kaam kar rahe ho." हमारे पास ये स्किल सेट है, कैन वी पार्टनर टुगेदर विद यू टू गिव अ मोर होलिस्टिक एक्सपीरियंस बिकॉज़ आई डोंट नो इट बाय गवर्नमेंट. सो इफ यू कैन टैग अलोंग विद एन एस्टैब्लिश्ड प्लेयर और अ बॉट इन वेंडर एंड क्रिएट अ सिनर्जिस्टिक करिकुलम एंड राइड अलोंग विद इट. सो ये जो तीन चार हमने देखे हैं आर सक्सेसफुल एग्जांपल्स ऑफ सम ऑफ आवर एंटरप्रेन्योर्स हू बीन एबल टू बिल्ड. अभी तो सब कुछ कोविड में क्वेश्चनेबल है बट इन द पास्ट we've seen these kind of mitigants towards your often asked problem of ab kya hoga, how do you build your skill. Is this something of a question, Ashish?
Yes, it does, definitely.
And if there's any other specific insight, I'm happy to take one or two examples and illustrate. Or
no, I mean, it makes sense. I mean, examples, Lend a Hand, I know very well. They have done some great work in terms of building partnership with the government and working at scale. So, yeah, I mean, you gave a very great example. That is true.
Yeah, and yeah. You know, so ek aur ab thode dekhega, ek to happiness curriculum ka ek hamare ek NGO samarthya jo abhi Punjab mein, which I was saying, you know, in collaboration with other NGOs has made an inroad. So some of these pratham ke sath pratham, because they have their presence and they're very, as far as I've heard and whatever I know of the organization of pratham, they're very open collaborators. Like I was telling, you know, one of our NGOs Manzil Mystic, wo music ab gaon gaon mein le ja paye hain. Right,
yeah.
And these are larger donors who have funding. So that could be one to tag along, carry along with people who have ability to raise funds, sustain funds. That could be an idea as well. So yeah. Just Ashwini, I don't know if you know collaboration with Educate Girls in Rajasthan will make sense for you, right? But those just opportunities open up is what we encourage all our entrepreneurs. And the other one definitely we are leveraging is community, especially in rural area. हमने देखा है हमारे लाइवलीहुड प्रोजेक्ट्स में, नॉट नेसेसली एजुकेशन में, बट अगर पंचायत गेट्स वोट्ड इन तो बहुत सारे बॉटलनेक्स iron out ho jate hain, not in conflict zones, not in probably your zone, Ashish, you're working in one of the toughest areas, but in the other areas, those funds get tapped into, if that helps.
Yeah.
And the other one is leveraging government schemes and subsidies. Tough to do, but if you can partner with somebody who enables those right to education kind of subsidies and schemes, or somebody who understands that network, I'm happy to connect you to Saras Foundation, which has done a terrific job in UP of enabling RT. Now, in your geography, it may not be relevant, but agar aisa kuch ho, to learning outcomes se, you can leverage partnerships.
Yeah.
So with that, Ashwini, I would want to ask you, Vidyalaya Udyam has been also been able to include a systemic lens to your work, right? What measures have you taken, and later if Ashish, you can also weigh in, especially during COVID, have you been able to change the game in any way, manner, form towards your own sustainability as well?
Yeah, thanks ma'am for the questions. As at Vidyalaya Udyam, we see the systemic lens with two key factors. The one is system practitioner and the second is with system beneficiary. तंत्र के जो प्रैक्टिशनर हैं वो हमारे लिए जो हमने अपना प्रोग्राम डिजाइन किया इस सिस्टम के लिए वो हैं सबसे पहले महिलाओं का कलेक्टिव और गांव के सरपंच या ओपिनियन लीडर कम्युनिटी लीडर जिनको बोलते हैं हमारे सिस्टम के बेनिफिशियरी हैं बच्चे जो कि इस पूरे सिनेरियो में जिनको हमको इनेबल करना है जिनके लिए हम अपना लक्ष्य लेकर चले तो इसमें अब तीनों स्टेक होल्डर को इंगेज करने के लिए वी हैव थ्री डिफरेंट प्रोग्राम द वन इज स्कूल एंटरप्राइज नेटवर्क जो कि विद्यालय उद्यम का एक कोर प्रोग्राम है स्कूल एंटरप्राइज नेटवर्क का लक्ष्य बच्चों के साथ एंटरप्रेन्योरियल माइंडसेट को प्रैक्टिस करने का है जिसमें बच्चे खुद अपने गांव की एक प्रॉब्लम को सॉल्व करते हैं आइडेंटिफाई करते हैं आर्टिकुलेट करते हैं सॉल्व करते हैं एंड देन उसको कम्युनिटी की मदद से लोकल रिसोर्सेज इंडिजिनस नॉलेज की हेल्प से एक प्रोटोटाइप डेवलप करते हैं उस प्रोटोटाइप को वो अपने कम्युनिटी को अपने सरपंच को या ओपिनियन लीडर को पिच करते हैं अब पिक्चर में आती हैं विमेन जैसे आशीष जी ने पहले ही कहा कि जो विमेन होती हैं वो सबसे पहले विक्टिम होती हैं किसी चीज का यहाँ पे ये भी देखा गया है कि विमेन होती हैं जो चीजों को सबसे पहले पिक करती हैं जो लीड करती हैं जो एक फैमिली के लिए फ्रंट लाइन योद्धा होती हैं तो वो कलेक्टिव के रूप में आती हैं और उस प्रोडक्ट को एज अ फुल फ्लेज बिजनेस मॉडल अनफोल्ड करती हैं ड्यूरिंग अवर फेलोशिप प्रोग्राम विच नेम ग्रामोन्मुख फेलोशिप प्रोग्राम ये एक 12 महीने का प्रोग्राम है जिसमें विमेन के साथ थोड़ी प्रोफेशनल कम्युनिकेशन और उनको साथ हम इस चीज की प्रैक्टिस करते हैं कि कैसे पंचायत और लोकल जो फंडर्स हैं उनसे आपको रिसोर्सेज मंगाने हैं और जो बच्चों को द्वारा बनाया गया प्रोडक्ट है उसको फुल फ्लेज बिजनेस में कैसे बदलते हैं एग्जांपल के लिए अब तक हमने वाटर फिल्टर पानी को एक जगह से दूसरी जगह फेच करने वाली मशीन कंस्ट्रक्शन वर्क और नरेगा के कामों को आसान बनाने के लिए कैरी लोड डिवाइसेस बच्चों के स्कूल में यूज करने वाली डेस्क ऐसी तमाम चीजें बना रहे हैं नाउ अब हम मूव कर रहे हैं थोड़ा ऑटोमेशन की तरफ इन बच्चों के साथ जैसे मैंने पहले कहा था ऑल द पिक्चर इज नॉट ग्लूमी यहाँ बहुत टैलेंटेड बच्चे भी हैं हमने शुरू तो किया था कि हम जो कंस्ट्रक्शन वर्क के लिए मशीन बनाए उसमें केवल एक लकड़ी का ढांचा था बच्चे खुद उस एग्जाम्पल के साथ आए कि सर इसको ऑटोमेटेड कर सकते हैं अगर थोड़ा बहुत हम कुछ भी यूज करें फिर हमारे पास थोड़ी इंजीनियरिंग की स्किल्स हैं तो हमने उसमें सेंसर और वो लगा के उसको थोड़ा ऑटोमेटेड किया इस तरीके से और फिर जब ये दोनों डेवलप प्रोग्राम हमारा हो जाता है ग्रामोन्मुख और स्कूल एंटरप्राइज फिर हम मूव करते हैं पंचायत इंक्यूबेशन सेंटर की तरफ पंचायत इंक्यूबेशन सेंटर एक प्लेस है जहाँ पे बेसिकली वीमेन और स्टूडेंट के बीच का जो गैप होता है वो ब्रिज होता है इनको सरपंच और पंचायत सेक्रेटरी लीड करते हैं इनका मेन काम होता है विमेन की बिजनेस को और स्टूडेंट्स के आइडियाज को आगे बढ़ाने के लिए फंड इकट्ठा करना तो ऐसे छोटे छोटे इंक्यूबेशन सेंटर हम बनाए और जैसा आपने बताया कोविड में हमको बहुत नुकसान हुआ नुकसान इस वजह से हुआ पहले जो 10 में से 6 बच्चे माइग्रेट करते थे आज वो 10 में से 8 हो गए क्योंकि इस 3 महीने के लॉकडाउन के दौरान थोड़ी बहुत गवर्नमेंट से जो सामान मिला कहीं पहुंचा कहीं नहीं पहुंचा, स्थिति गंभीर हो गई, बच्चों को लेबर जॉब के लिए जाना पड़ा, कुछ कुछ गांव यंग लर्नर से खाली हो गए। ऐसे कंडीशन में हमने छोटे माइक्रो लैब बना दिए, पहले तो हम गांव के स्कूल में लैब बनाते थे, अब तो स्कूल भी बंद है, हमने मिट्टी के छोटे छोटे घर बनाने शुरू किए और ताकि वो इंडिपेंडेंट हो, बच्चों का हो, उस पर कोई और अधिकार न जमा ले आके, थोड़ा टफनेस होती है गांव में, तो उस छोटे छोटे सेंटर्स में वो अपना लैब चलाते हैं एंड प्रोग्राम इज कंटिन्यूइंग की स्कूल एंटरप्राइज नेटवर्क ग्राम उन्मुख एंड NPIC। तो डिसरप्ट हुआ बट अगेन वी रीबिल्ड इट, उसको हमने स्टार्ट किया। सो इस तरीके से जो 2 assumption हम तोड़ रहे हैं, बार बार लोगों के मन में ये assumption होता है कि हम तो आदिवासी लोग हैं, वी आर नॉट मेड फॉर क्रिएटिव जॉब्स, हम नया काम नहीं कर सकते रचना वाला, वी बॉर्न टू वर्क फॉर अदर। बट दीज 3 program, द SEN, ग्रामोन्मुख एंड पंचायत इंक्यूबेशन सेंटर, वो रेजिलियंस बिल्ड करती है कि यू कैन स्टार्ट योर ओन एंड यू हैव द एबिलिटी टू सॉल्व योर ओन प्रॉब्लम एंड कन्वर्ट इन टू होल बिजनेस मॉडल। सो नाउ मैं मूव करूंगा आशीष जी के तरफ, वो बताएं कि कोविड में उन्होंने किस तरीके से कॉप अप किया सिचुएशन के और उनके सिस्टमिक लेंसेस क्या हैं।
थैंक यू अश्विनी। सो एज स्टेटेड अर्लियर, वी हैव नॉट बीन एबल टू रीच आवर चिल्ड्रन थ्रू एनी ऑनलाइन मीडियम। गवर्नमेंट ने ऑनलाइन लर्न एजुकेशन पोर्टल बनाया इन मार्च इन छत्तीसगढ़, एंड द होल पोर्टल हैज बीन एक्सेसिबल टू हार्डली 30% अक्रॉस द स्टेट एंड सुकमा जैसे डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स में, एंड ऐसे 10-12 डिस्ट्रिक्ट्स हैं छत्तीसगढ़ में जहाँ पे रीच लेस देन 10% है, सुकमा में लेस देन 5% है। सो एवरीबडी जम्प्ड इनटू ऑनलाइन एजुकेशन, हम भी जम्प किए इन द बिगनिंग एंड वी क्रिएटेड रीड अलाउड स्टोरीज जो हम व्हाट्सएप और यूट्यूब के माध्यम से वी वर शेयरिंग, एंड आयरॉनिकली द कॉन्टेंट वॉज रीचिंग एवरीबडी एक्सेप्ट द चिल्ड्रन इन सुकमा, and I was part of multiple forums जहाँ पे offline mediums पे discussion हो रहा था, and we realized that शहरों में एक बड़ा interesting concept आया कि online medium वो है जब आप video classes ले पा रहे हो, offline medium वो है जब आप SMS और WhatsApp कर पा रहे हो, and we were like कि भाई हम किस category में आते हैं, offline is offline for us, there is no SMS, no WhatsApp, so we then decided that we'll do whatever we can at our end, and we go decided to go ahead with the offline approach, and we have created offline learning kits which are combination of worksheets, activities, project based learning which are contextual in nature, brings in the local ecosystem of the child, engagement engages community and parents, and we have been partnering with organizations like Life Lab or Education Above All, and currently we are reaching 10,000 children in Sukma out of the official 27,000 children who don't have access to online education. So the around 50,000 children are enrolled. Government says that 27,000 bachche ko bilkul bhi access nahi hai. To humne wo number maan liya ki theek hai 27,000 hai, usme se 10,000 bachchon ko hum apni taraf se serve kar rahe hain. So we are taking help of community volunteers and the local administration, teachers and unke through kar rahe hain. और इसमें से 7,000 बच्चे उन एरियाज के हैं जो कि नक्सल डोमिनेटेड एरियाज हैं, नक्सल कंट्रोल्ड एरियाज हैं, उनमें पिछले 10 सालों से स्कूल्स बंद थे और अभी कम्युनिटी की सहायता से 93 स्कूल्स वापस खुले हैं, एक झोपड़ियों में चल रहे हैं, और लगभग 4,000 आउट ऑफ स्कूल बच्चे वापस शिक्षा से जुड़ पाए, तो इन स्कूल्स में हम ये किट्स पहुंचा रहे हैं। The offline kits are also being used by other organizations. There's Protsahan in Delhi, which is using it. Upkram, Akshay Patra is using it across Odisha, Karnataka, Maharashtra, Gujarat, Assam, Delhi. So हम कई बार यहाँ पे administration को बोलते भी हैं कि भाई आप लोग हमारी कोई कदर नहीं करते, बाहर दुनिया में लोग हमारे सामान को use करना चाह रहे हैं। तो ये irony है, but then we live with that. However, I would like to highlight the fact that as a system comprising CSOs and government. We are weak with the basics of content and pedagogy. We can keep changing mediums of how that information or how that knowledge is passed on, but without working on the content and pedagogy, without working on the basics, it won't be more than a band-aid solution. So the government has brought in offline approaches like community volunteers, loudspeaker school, gaon mein panchayat mein loudspeaker laga diya, ya Bluetooth radio ke through feature phones mein stories aur content share karna. Lekin wo sare effective utne nahi hai because the capacity of teachers and their expertise on content and pedagogy is very poor in such areas. So aap medium se kitna bhi khelo, hum kitna bhi fancy tech platform bhi leke aa jaye, wo कुछ नहीं हो रहा है. सो आई थिंक दिस इज समथिंग टू लर्न फ्रॉम द करंट सिचुएशन, स्पेशली विद रिस्पेक्ट टू द एजुकेशन एस्पेक्ट. एंड विद दिस आई वुड आल्सो लाइक टू क्लोज द डिस्कशन नाउ. आई मीन बड़े अच्छे इंटरेस्टिंग इंसाइट मिले अश्विनी, आपके बहुत सारे आइडियाज मिले, अंशु मैम ने जो आइडियाज दिए हैं ऑफ कोलैबोरेशन विद द गवर्नमेंट एंड हाउ डू वी लेवरेज द लो हैंगिंग फ्रूट्स इन द सिस्टम. सो वेरी हेल्पफुल. I was typing on my laptop while you were speaking, so wo notes maine le liye to see how what all can be done. And I would like to invite any questions that is from the audience. We can take a couple of questions and then close this for discussion. So I mean, there is one question for Ashwini. If you could quickly answer, when children come back after working in big cities, what is their response to studying on or receiving education?
Thanks, Jovita, for this question. And बच्चे बाहर से आते हैं तो वो दो तरीके की कंडीशन में होते हैं. एक बच्चे वो होते हैं जो वापस तो इंटरेस्टेड हो जाते हैं कि सर हमको पढ़ना है, मगर पैसे का चस्का तो लग चुका होता है. घर वाले भी अल्टीमेटली यही बोलते हैं, पढ़ के करोगे क्या, कमाएंगे. एंड सेकेंड, कुछ बच्चे ऐसे भी होते हैं जो ऐसे कंडीशन में चले जाते हैं जो वहां पे कर्ज ले लेते हैं. जब आप गूगल सर्च करिए, आप देखिए कि कैसे काफी जर्नलिस्ट लोगों ने इस पे रिसर्च किया है कि कई सारे बच्चे जाते हैं और ऐसे एनवायरनमेंट में फंस जाते हैं कि जब वो वापस आते हैं तो उनके हाथ या पैर नहीं होते हैं, क्योंकि वो हैवी मशीनरीज के साथ काम कर रहे होते हैं. दे आर हजारों ऐसे केसेस और हर साल आते हैं, जर्नलिस्ट उस पर बहुत रिसर्च भी करते हैं. तो अब उन बच्चों के लिए तो कोई रास्ता नहीं होता वापस शहर जाने का. और जो बच्चे एक बार जा चुके होते हैं, अब उनके पास रिटर्न पाथ नहीं होता क्योंकि वो कर्ज में फंस चुके होते हैं. एक्स्ट्रा काम करते हैं तो उस रिलीज करने के लिए नशे में भी फंस चुके होते हैं. कुछ फॉर्चुनेट बच्चे होते हैं जो वापस आते हैं थोड़े पेरेंट्स के हेल्प से और वापस अपनी पढ़ाई को स्टडी कर पाते. तो दो रिस्पॉन्स बहुत कॉमन है. एक, या तो वो किसी अनसर्टेनिटी का शिकार हो जाते हैं, और कुछ होते हैं जो वापस अपनी पढ़ाई पूरी करते हैं मगर पैसे का चस्का लग चुका होता है, फिर मुश्किल होता है वो नशा उतारना, वो वापस जाना चाहते हैं बार बार.
थैंक यू अश्विनी. सो इन द इंटरेस्ट ऑफ द टाइम वी विल हैव टू क्लोज द डिस्कशन. थैंक यू सो मच अंशु मैम, इट वॉज ग्रेट हियरिंग फ्रॉम यू. And I look forward to some more insights on another platform now after post Zoom. Thank you so much, and thank you, Ashwini. I would like Parul to take over from here.
Yeah, I also just wanted to say thank you. I think this is a very refreshing change as a format where it's practitioners talking with their ground experiences. I think it was very inspiring for me to hear both of you.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Parul, over to you.
Yes. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Ashish, Ashwini, and Anshu, for sharing your experiences and insights with us. This conversation helped us understand the challenges that a child encounters in conflict and poverty, and how education plays a major role in giving these children hope. Hope for a better future, not only for them, but for their entire community. So thanks a lot for having this discussion. With this, I would again like to remind our viewers to not forget to fill the Google form shared with you in the chat box in case you would like to connect with these organizations. So with this, we have come to a close for our day one, and this was all about day one. Today, we delve deeper into understanding how context affects the future of a child, and different approaches civil society organizations are taking to support them. but don't get disappointed, because tomorrow we'll be continuing with these conversations and we have another set of interesting sessions lined up for it. We look forward to your encouraging presence tomorrow. So requesting all of you to please join us. And I hope you had a great evening, and thank you for joining us today and making this event a big success. Thanks a lot.